Antonio Carzaniga is a professor in the Faculty of Informatics at USI, the Università Svizzera Italiana. His research interests cover a wide range of topics in distributed systems, and some of the things he's going to talk about today are content-based networking, information center networking, and distributed publish-subscribe systems. So, Antonio.
Thank you.
Beautiful. All right. So as you can see, we have 214 slides. Okay. Thanks a lot for having me. It's really great. So I'm going to start right to the presentation. Feel free to interrupt. Happy to have an interactive conversation here. So the idea of ICN, generally speaking, is to reinvent a little bit or to maybe improve the thin waste. And I'm going to describe it in terms of the two mainstream projects in this area, CCN and NDN. CCN is not meant to be on top of NDN. There are alternatives, but you know, it doesn't fit. And the idea of these mainstream projects is to redesign the thin waste so that it looks a little bit like the web. It's a pull service where you get information, either objects or chunks of those objects, by name. That's the main idea, and everybody in this room probably knows about it, so I'm not going to spend too much time talking about it. Underneath, there's a network architecture, there's the FIBS, there's pending interest tables, and so on. I want to criticize or use this architecture as a to introduce new ideas. And the main criticism on which I based the new ideas is on the naming scheme. So how do they define information? Well, they name it. They name the data. They mean CCN and NDN. And they name it using hierarchical names, something like the example you see on the slides here. And the nice thing about hierarchical names is that they are familiar to many, the idea of the file system, very similar to that. 10 minutes. Okay.
No, he's supposed to start at 10:30.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. All right. So what's the problem with these hierarchical names? Well, they essentially partition the data space. So they create the hierarchical partitioning of the data space. And while that might be good as a classification scheme, you might remember early days of the internet for everyday people. We had Yahoo, the hierarchical partitioning. That didn't quite work. And then Google came about and figured out that bags of words work better. So that's kind of the argument I want to give. So there are many things that you can express. Say you are like me, or used to be, really, a United frequent flyer. So maybe you want to access flight information about this particular flight from New York, Newark to San Francisco, going to United first, and then checking their flight information, and then Newark, and then San Francisco. But if you are at Newark, and you want to check flights out of Newark, maybe United flights, maybe not, but anyway, flights that go to San Francisco, how do you do that? So maybe you choosing a particular partitioning of the data space forces you into that partitioning. It's not so flexible. So that's essentially the argument I'm giving. So what I propose instead is something else. Another observation on these names is that they are not just names in the sense that they describe information. They also contain, in the most recent incarnation of these mainstream systems, a routable prefix. So the first part of the name is typically what amounts to a DNS name. What is that essentially? That is a network-defined address masquerading as a so-called name. That's what it is. It's a network-defined address. The network chooses those things. The application doesn't get to choose those things. Then there's a part that is really a proper name, and then there's something that might relate to transport, it might relate to chunking, it might relate to other components of that object. And then the whole thing is used for caching, which is also not quite right, because caching should be location independent. Why should I have the identification of an object that has a routable prefix in it? It's not exactly the right thing. So instead, what do we propose? Well, we propose bags of words. Essentially, we propose to describe data with tag sets. So this might be an announcement for an exhibit at the New York Museum of Modern Art. And it's defined by the tags that you see in the first line, highlighted in boldface. This is a similar chunk of data. It might be a block of data within a stream that is defined, meaning described, by the sets of tags that you see at the top. And we call that set of tags a descriptor. A descriptor is simply a way to describe data, really to describe it from the viewpoint of the application. The purpose of that is to describe it from the viewpoint of the application. So we call that thing a descriptor, and the rest of the presentation we're going to, show it with this teal color box. And it's just a set of string tags. Now, in addition to a single descriptor, we group descriptors into what we call predicates. And I'm going to show you later in the presentation. We're going to associate those predicates with interfaces and data in the fibs. But for now, all I want to show you is the matching semantics. And you'll notice that this corresponds roughly to the longest prefix semantics in current IP tables or CCN tables, except that here the relation is subset. It's not prefix matching, it's subset. We have a bag of words and the relation is subset. So this particular descriptor that you have over here, let's see if maybe I can even point to, yes, this one particular descriptor over here matches the predicate because there is a set in the predicate that is a subset of this descriptor. This is the matching semantics. So now I'm going to give you more examples so that this notion will be clear, hopefully, for the rest of the presentation. High level, we have the network, we have many applications, and these applications advertise these predicates. They advertise sets of tags. That's what predicates are, sets of tags. So maybe another application comes along, the application makes a request or sends a notification, and this notification will be sent, or this request will be forwarded, towards all the application that advertise a predicate that contains a subset of the descriptor in the request. So this particular one has a set of tags, Emma Goldman, anarchism, autobiography, which will be forwarded where? Let's see if you're paying attention. Who said that? Two and three, because the first one matches because of anarchism and the last one because of Emma Goldman. They're both subsets. Here's another example. This might be an update for my favorite software, the Emacs editor. And this is supposed to go where? Only one, yes. Okay, there's some other examples. Nobody cares about the US election. Well, I do, but that goes nowhere. Events, Italian elections, yeah, that goes everywhere. So, the idea of what I'm proposing today is essentially to break apart, to essentially undo the triple duty, the bundling of these three functionalities into names. I want to have something that deals with the network address part of name, something that deals with the descriptor of the object, and something that deals with transport and caching. So what I'm proposing is this. Three forms of addresses, not one, three. The most important ones are the first two. So the first one is descriptors. I already gave a description of them. They're intended to be expressive, and they are, this is the keyword, application defined. They're not network defined, they're application defined fully. Then there's locators. They're opaque. In this case, they might be physical coordinates. Anything that the network defines, and anything that the network understands, it can deal with quickly, okay? Efficient. And then identifiers. Identifiers are supposed to be identifiers. They're unique identifiers of content, or chunks of content, that they can be used for the purpose of caching and transport. So again, descriptors are meaningful, useful for applications. They have application semantics. They're application defined. Network doesn't get to choose them. Application gets to choose them. Locators is just the other way around. They're way more efficient. The network decides. The network knows how to deal with them. Identifiers are identifiers. So with this, this is the network interface that I'm proposing. An application can advertise, in this case I call register, but effectively advertise descriptors in those predicates. Those go into the network. They form fibs and ribs, and I'll show you how later. So that later another application can come along and produce a packet, and the packet will be routed by or forwarded by the descriptor. So it goes to the corresponding descriptor at the other end. In addition to that, we can do it not just unicast, we can do it multicast with what we call a replication factor, k. K can be infinity also. Then an application can also ask the network to give it its locator. It's not that the application knows it, the network knows it, it gets it from the network. And I can use that locator just like any other piece of data. So for example, I can communicate it to the other side so that the other side can use that locator to get back to the requester. Okay? So anyway, there's two sides to this network. So our thin waist, maybe not so thin, has two sides to it. One is tags and the other one is locators. Okay. So there's really two primitives, send to descriptor and send to locators. And now I'm going to tell you how we do that, how to make it efficient, how to make it work. Okay. Before I go down to the network level and tell you how to make it work, I want to show you that this particular interface with these two sides, the blue and orange or teal and orange, they can be used in combination to express all sorts of different communication patterns. So the very first one I'm going to show you is an example of the equivalent of, I would say, maybe a classic traditional TCP connection. So in this case, the server side of the TCP connection, again, it's analogy, it's not exactly the same thing, has a stable address, and that is a descriptor. The client, the one making the connection, gets its own locator, produces a packet that is addressed by A's stable address, which is a descriptor, puts in that packet some data, an ID of that data. Notice that the ID has subscript BA because that's the stream going from B to A, just like any TCP connection. It's a duplex connection. There's two streams from B to A, A to B. And then it sends it with replication factor 1 because it's unicast in this case. It goes over there. At this point, A also gets its own locator, unpacks the packet, and produces another packet that is addressed by locator now to B with the next packet, the request for the next packet. So this is this ID here. And with the data with its own ID over here. And now we're in TCP land. We know the two sides know their address, they know the IDs of the two connections, so they can proceed just like in TCP. So send by locator, unpack, increment the ID, send by locator, unpack, and so on. So this is essentially TCP in this network. Here's the more interesting one. Here's basic push. This is my PhD dissertation. So this is PubSub. Instead of doing unicast, we do multicast. Instead of doing address-based, we do content-based. So, but in this network, it's exactly the same. The interested parties, the subscribers, they essentially they register, they advertise a particular descriptor that describes information they're interested in. In this case, say, breaking news, since application B is interested in breaking news. Similarly, application A is interested in news about New York City. Those things, again, they go into the network, they form the basis for the fibs, so that when a new message comes along, addressed by descriptor, with a particular descriptor that happens to match both, well, that packet goes to both. Basic push, this basic event notification. You can also combine basic event notification with a kind of a push plus pull multicast. And this is what I'm going to show the last example here. Again, I get my locator, produce a packet that goes to descriptor-based forwarding. But I also post my locator, the source locator, goes to the various destinations, and the various destinations now start pulling that object, or the rest of the object. They do it initially independently in the same way that we've seen in the first example. They send a packet, orange one, because it's addressed by locator this time. Everything is fast. Information goes back. The other one does the same. information goes back. And of course, just like in CCN, there's caching. So you can request the next chunk of data. The data goes back, but it's also cached so that when C comes along and requests exactly the same block, and I know it's exactly the same block, not because it's in the name, but because it's in the ID, then I can reply immediately and have effectively a multicast tree. So the effect is the classic effect that is Van Jacobsen described since the very beginning of CCN as a multicast tree. So I hope that by now I convince you that this idea of this tags plus locators gives you a lot of flexibility, a lot of power. So you can do all sorts of things. You can come up with transport level protocols, application level protocols that have to do with mobility, vendorification, all sorts of things. I won't spend time on this, but offline we can talk about it. Now I'm going to switch over to the network side, to how we actually do this. How do you implement this multimodal addressing scheme in the network? Well, we need two schemes. We need to be able to forward packets by locator. We need to be able to forward packets by descriptor. What's our insight? How to do it? Trees. Remember this word, trees. The future of the internet will be full of trees. We all love trees. Okay, so how do we do it? First, I'm going to describe how to do routing by descriptor on trees. So the first thing you do, you cover the network with a tree. In this case, I'm using a spanning tree denoted with the green dashed lines here. And now at every the fibs at every node, they annotate the edges of that tree with predicates, with those descriptors, sets of descriptors. Notice, for example, the case of T1, that tree number one, and interface number one. This is this thing over here that essentially represents the union of the predicates that are reachable through interface number one. Okay, that's intuitive. So if a packet comes along that has descriptor D and D happens to match, again by the matching semantics subset P sub G, then what happens? Well, it's forwarded down that way. Okay, easy. Locators. How do we deal with locators? Well, locators, we're fortunate because for trees, there's a well-known, or I should say not so well-known, it should be well-known, routing scheme for trees that is absolutely fantastic. It's spectacular. Why is it so spectacular? Because it has an efficient labeling scheme that produces all sorts of labels around the network on that tree, again, for that particular tree. And the labels are 46 bits for a network the size of the internet. And those labels are not just the addresses, they are the addresses and the fib. Unbelievable. But it's real, but it actually works. And we've done it, we've tested it. On this computer, actually, a computer like this one that I'm presenting with, you can forward 250 million packets with this forwarding scheme. It's fantastic. This is the code, and literally this is the code. What you see here, these things are the fib and the address, sort of. I mean, it's complicated. You're not supposed to understand it, but what you should take away from this is that it's 10 CPU instructions. This is the forwarding algorithm. This is it. If you look at it, it's a bunch of shifts, ifs, and equality checks. No more than that. So the getaway message here, the takeaway message is labels are extremely fast on trees. Extremely. Okay, so there's a problem, of course. Sounds great, you know, I'm selling you trees. What's the problem with trees? Well, first of all, they tend to stretch paths. So if I need to go, in this case, from I to J on the network, I could use one hop on the tree. It's four hops. It's bad, huh? So I have a stretch of four for this particular path. They also increase congestion, reduce reliability, because, of course, if I go to go from the left side of the network to the right side of the network, I could use three edges in one case in the network, and here I can use only one. So that's bad. So again, congestion. What's the solution to this? The theory people figured this out, of course, and the solution is to use multiple trees. So instead of just one, I can use two, or K trees, or N trees. In this case, the red tree and the green tree. In this, for the example before, if I split the traffic, say, evenly between the two trees, now in expectation, meaning on average, going from I to J, the cost is going to be 2.5, not 4. Still, I have a stretch of 2.5. Yes?
So if you see the whole, isn't it as one tree, or is it like for one network divider and trees?
Okay. I'm not sure. I'm trying to go straight to the answer. So the question is, what do you do? How do you envision this scheme to work at the level of the provider or the internet as a whole? Is that the question? Okay, yes. We developed this scheme exactly as you suggest. There are trees at the AS level and trees at the network provider. The network provider has a lot more control. They can have many trees. They can have trees that they engineer the way they want. At the global level, this is a tougher problem. In fact, in my opinion, it's the biggest open problem, how to represent policy routing with trees and how to do it in, you know, to make everybody happy over the internet. That's the tough part that I'm not discussing here. Happy to discuss it later, but yes. But yes, we have developed a hierarchical scheme. And I don't think I have time, or do I? I think there's a design problem, obviously, here, how you design those trees. And we developed a couple of heuristics, one that is latency and one that tries to, I'm going to skip them quickly because I want to get to the conclusion, and one that tries to balance latency and congestion. These, by the way, are also well-known theoretical problems. There's very well-known algorithms. It's theoretically, it's a shut and close. It's a tight solution, how to best approximate a network with trees. In this case, we just did our experiments with heuristics because they're easier to work with in a distributed way, which makes sense for routing. Anyway, how does this actually work on the internet? What I'm showing you here is the AS level topology and stretch, and how stretch is distributed over the various pairs of autonomous systems on the internet as a function of the number of trees using those two heuristics, the latency and latency and congestion. Now notice, yes, the maximum values are bad. That means that there are some particular, there's one pair of ASs that suffer a stretch of up to, say, 9. That might be bad. Although I'm told at the AS level, nobody cares about latency. Or stretch, I should say, not latency. They do care about latency, don't care about stretch. But the 99 percentile is very, very close to 1. And the median is pretty much 1. So the conclusion here is that, yes, the internet can be effectively covered with trees. So trees can approximate the internet very well. Shouldn't be surprising because the AS level topology already looks like a tree. It's hierarchical in nature. So, and there are similar results for congestion. Now, this says that trees are good, but how good are they in terms of scalability? This is a big problem. We now have to represent these things and we have to deal with them in routing and forwarding. So what do we have to deal with? Well, there's two parts. We have to deal with the trees. So we have to remember the labels and we have to know the adjacency for each node. That's cheap. That's very small. I'm not even going to talk about it for the rest of the presentation. But the other part is huge, because for every tree we have the predicates, and those represent the descriptors of every object in the network. So how big is that? That's really big. We need to compress it, and we have some ideas on how to do it. We're going to do it by compressing the individual descriptors, by compressing descriptors within predicates together, a single predicate. And we're also, and this is the one interesting insight, we're going to aggregate across trees. So I'm going to show you an example of how to do that. First one should be obvious to anybody in this room. Everybody knows what a Bloom filter is. You go from a set to a bit vector through a bunch of hash functions. It's effectively just a way to compress a set. And it works well in this case because the set is made of a few elements. You know, the number of tags is small, like bags of words. You know, nobody writes 50,000 words in a Google search.
Okay, and in the examples that I show in the numeric example, we use in our experiments 192 bits, which is an exaggeration anyway. It's an overestimation. Aggregation, how does aggregation work? It's analogous to prefix aggregation, except it's subset. So if we have these descriptors, the first one, anything that matches the first one is also gonna match the last one. Also, anything that matches the second one is gonna match the last one. Also, anything that matches the third one is gonna match the last one. So we can get rid of those three and just use the subset. So this is basic aggregation in TagNet. Again, it's analogous to prefix aggregation, but it's subset aggregation. Here's the more interesting one. If you go start from the Bloom filters and then you remove by aggregation, you're still left with a table that essentially duplicates a lot of information by tree. So you still have the red part of the table and the green part of the table. And notice that they have similar data. So for example, there's A is over here, A is over here, D is over here, D is over here. So one way to do it is to flip those tables and to index them by descriptor, which also allows for further compression. So we've done that and we measure this, and I'm going to show you two or three charts that show the actual number. So this is memory in gigabytes of a concrete implementation for, now you're going to ask, well, what workload, what objects, what descriptors? Yes, that's tough. There's a lot of information behind the scenes I'm not showing. Happy to discuss it if you want. This is roughly 50 million users over the internet. I know it's not that big, but I'll show you scalability numbers also. What's interesting to see, and this is AES level, this is gateway ribs. So they contain both the high level, AES level trees and the low level intra AES trees. Notice that the absolute numbers are relatively low, 4 gigabytes, you know, that's my phone. And also notice that the cost of 8 trees, there's a distribution and the distribution is the number of trees. 8 trees cost roughly twice the cost of 1 tree. What that says is that there is scalability in aggregating across trees. So this is another chart that shows scalability in the number of users. We go from 50 million to 500 million and you see the behavior, it kind of flattens out. What that says? That says that there is scalability in aggregation. Why? Because people in different communities that are intended to represent culturally, cultural affinity and so on, they're pretty much requesting the same kind of information. So there's aggregation. Okay, so subset aggregation is effective. And if you project that to, say, 2.5 billion users, maybe a more realistic number for the real internet, again, you get to just a few more gigabytes of memory. Not impossible. There's a lot to do here, but these numbers are indicative, we believe. Now, I told you about routing. Let's move on to forwarding and see how you can actually forward based on those descriptors. They look very complicated. I need to do this complicated matching function, which is for descriptors. I said locators, I'm not even going to talk about them. They're so fast. But descriptors are costly. So how do they work? This is what the FIB would look like. It's a bunch of bit sets mapped to output ports. So how do we do matching? How do we do subset matching on that one? Well, we represent the set of bit sets as a try. So this is a try that it's classic prefix try. And you do matching by subset, effectively by walking through that try. I'm going to show you an example. So let's say you have to match this particular descriptor, 10101000100, which is corresponding to the set 1358. So you go to 1, and you go down a subtree every time that the position at that node exists in the set that you're trying to match. So does it exist? Yes. So go down. Is 5 in the set? Yes. Go down. Okay, you reach a terminal node, so that means that you're going to forward to interface 2. Again, backtrack. This is just a tree walk. and the tree walk that simply skips subtrees where we don't have an element. In this case, we do have the element, go down, do have the element, go down. Back here, do we have the element? No, so we can skip the subtree. Do we have the element here? So we have to go down. So pretty much it's a tree walk that can only skip trees whenever the element at that node or in that subtree is not in the matching set, in the incoming descriptor.
So is this the least upper bound set theory? Is he just implementing a match for the least upper bound?
The least upper bound.
It feels like it's set theory, and you're finding the binding set, which has a condition which says, I must lie in this set, and just pruning the tree based on that.
I think, I'm not sure I completely understand the question. I think the answer is yes, meaning that we have a set of sets, and we have a query set, and we're supposed to find either all or the largest. We developed two algorithms, all or the largest subsets of that set. Yes. Now, this is the basic idea, and it was developed by Rivest in 1970. I think it was his PhD thesis. So we took the same approach, and we developed a whole bunch of optimizations for this one, heuristics and algorithmic optimization. So the first one is, I'm going to show you, many are by annotating the tree with the ranges of weights that you have underneath. They allow you to skip more in this walk. There are also structural changes. So notice that the size of the tree depends on the orders of the bits. So what we do is to take the frequency distribution of the bits, of the bit positions in the sets, we sort them by frequency, and that gives us a way to share the prefixes, because now the bit positions that are more frequent, meaning the ones that have the larger subtree, will be at the top, so they will be shared. We also have chains, what we call terminal chains, actually, in this tree that are simply not a tree, they're just a linked list. So what we do is we compress them and we bundle them together, and it's simpler to deal with data structure that is quicker to deal with. And in addition to that, we use an in-memory representation of this tree that is as efficient as we can. We turn it into a binary tree with the first child and then the sibling list, and then we pack it into an array where the next sibling is implicit in the sequence of the array. And I'm not showing it here because it's complicated. We actually lay it out in memory so that the memory access pattern is cache friendly in the typical walk. We've done it. So these are the numbers. On a commodity CPU for the type of fibs that I was showing in the examples earlier, which represent, as I said, 500 million users, up to 500 million users, the throughput is reasonable. It's not high. I know some of you are thinking, what? That's in K packets per second. That's ridiculous. We're at Cisco. We do a lot more than that. That's true, but that's one relatively inexpensive CPU, and it's for descriptor matching. If you actually, and it's a respectable number anyway, excuse me. If you actually mix descriptor traffic with locator-based traffic, then the picture becomes a lot better. Because you can imagine that most of the flows are going to have most of the packets that are locator-based forwarded. They're not descriptors. Descriptors play a role either at the beginning or in once in a while packets that are mounting to notifications in an event notification system. Most bulk data transfer happens by locator. So if you, this is, it's difficult to explain exactly what's in this chart, but it's essentially saying if you have most of the flows that are traditional pull flows, and the flows have a lot of follow-up interest, meaning they have relatively large objects, then most of the traffic is going to be, meaning most of the packets are going to be forwarded by locator. So the effective throughput, meaning the average throughput, meaning the real throughput, is going to be much higher. Now, on this cheap single CPU, you can forward millions of packets per second. and these are other numbers, similar, and they have to do with packet size and the study of how these flows place with packet size. I want to conclude now. So what I presented is an idea of a thin waist that maybe is not so thin, not so thick either, has two sides to it. The network has two primitives, not just one, two. One is forward this packet by descriptor. So send it to an end host, an end application, that has advertised a matching descriptor, one or more. Another one that says send to locator. What's a locator? It's a network-defined object, ID, address. Doesn't mean anything to the application, but it's super fast. It's very efficient. And this can be done. It can be done relatively efficiently. We also studied other at the both for routing and forwarding. We believe that one good structure to use for forwarding and routing is trees, and because trees have this nice property that they allow for loop-free routing, they make a lot of routing decisions easy. And also, they have this wonderful routing scheme for labels, for network-defined labels, that is super efficient. And if you combine the efficiency of labels with the expressiveness of descriptors, you can have something that is useful for applications and at the same time doable and fast from the viewpoint of engineering the network. And you can express many things, you know, traditional pull, multicast, push, push and pull. Mobility is also something that you can deal with in a better way here, because again, you separate the locators from the descriptors. The object that is described by the descriptor stays described as a descriptor, but it might move in the sense that its locator changes. But its descriptor doesn't have to change. So if you decouple those two, I think you have an advantage. I think I'm way early, and so I'm very happy to take questions. Yes?
So if you do descriptor-based forwarding,
yes,
then you're essentially using the Bloom filters internal to the network.
Correct.
And you probably have to do a match of the real tags of the...
At the application, yeah.
The Bloom filters would probably, well, would certainly cause...
false positives.
Of some false positives.
Yes.
Do you have a feel for the number of those? And do you have a feel for attacks that might be possible if you know how the Bloom filter works?
Okay, very interesting questions. Too many to really get into it. Meaning the security part is very, I was referring to the security part. The first part is, I think, easy. So we designed all our experiments on Bloom filters of 192 bits. I think this is a safe choice. With 15 tags, you have 10 to the minus 11. This is just an example, but you can do the math in every specific case. Very easy, the usual typical Bloom filter math. And if you have a tag set of 10 tags, which I think is probably very rare, and two incompatible tags that differ by three tag sets, they differ by three tags, the false positive probability is 10 to the minus 11. Yeah. So
if everything is random, it's not. Another curve can choose the increase the probability.
That's the other part of the question that I said was tougher. Yes.
But even if there is no attacker, the tags are not random. Some tags are very, very common. Users use tags which are not very specific.
You're right, but this doesn't apply in this case. The tags that are not in S2, so the ones that for which, okay, this is a false positive. It doesn't match. Why doesn't it match? Because there is a component of one descriptor that isn't in the other one, right? It's not a subset, okay? So however random these things are, the reality is that there's three tags that don't match, right? Okay, doesn't matter how common these things are. If the hash functions are decent, this is the false positive probability, okay? Now, you're asking about the question, you know, how likely is it that they don't match? Because, well, that's a separate discussion. Now, going back to the security question, The security question is fundamental. It's not just a security question, it's a policy question. You can imagine that, okay, I have control over these things, sure, I'll stick a whole bunch of ones in there. This packet is going to go everywhere, right? Or when I advertise the empty set. So I'm going to get all the traffic from the internet. Okay, this is where policies come in. Okay, you want to advertise the empty set, I'll charge you. You want to publish something or use this hamming weight, now you pay, say, exponentially with a hamming weight. I haven't solved all the problem. I'm just, as you can imagine, waving my hands, but this is the idea. So yes, it is an issue, but it's an issue we can deal with. I don't think it's a fundamental issue. Did I convince you? Maybe not.
Almost.
Not quite. You know. Okay, fine, thank you.